So let's get right to it. Next lightning talk is from Fedor, or he goes by Ted, but he also has a fascinating history about his name that you should ask about afterwards. And I'll hand it over to you. Take it away.
Okay, thank you. Okay, here it is. So my talk will be about using formal concept analysis, whatever it is. I guess that nobody here have ever heard about formal concept analysis, am I right? Yeah, that's the case. So I have a double affiliation, so one of them is Yandex, and the other one is Higher School of Economics, and so it is the theory comes back from Higher School of Economics, and the practical tasks are from Yandex, so it would be a challenge. So I would wish to be able to use the previous experience, but nobody today told any words about model-based, so just to remember some key facts about this. It is a kind of cycle between the abstract things, like models and abstract tests, and the real life where you have the system and the test that you run. And there are several ways how to get actually, the model, it could be obtained either like Oracle, that is a kind of implementation that works just the requirements are. And so the other hand is to get test sequences which should be run over the system under test. And after you implement the model, you can get the test output, either it is pass or fail. And as for the modeling, there are several approaches how to do this exactly. First of all is to extract from the existing system how does it really works. It is of a special interest in the projects with long history and a lot of product features. The other hand is to model before implementation. That would be quite applicable to crucial things. And so the third approach is just what we see in real life and just to build both the system and the model. So the alternative is just to do it online or offline, whether we use the system under test or not. And in offline case, we could just generate test cases and somehow postpone them to the system under test. So for possible implementations of the model base, there is a set of them, like theorem proving state machines, and so on and so forth. And now I would like to say some words about the theory that is completely from the other hand in terms of test case derivation. So it came from algebraic theories. It is rather new. It is called formal concept analysis. And it mainly works with such thing as formal context. It is a triple when you have a set of objects, set of attributes, and binary relation over these things. And this binary relation means that an object has an attribute, quite intuitive. And so then we have special operator that are shown with this quotation mark, and they say that from the set of objects, we can get all the attributes that are common for them. And vice versa, from a set of attributes, gets the set of objects that has all these attributes. And how can we use this? Actually, we can find, in some sense, maximal subsets of objects and attributes that share and form the ideal concept. What a concept? It means that you have set objects, they share some set of attributes, and this set of attributes is just general for all the objects. And these objects can be, this concept could be naturally ordered with this, such kind of thing like set theory operations. You mean that one concept is more general than the other if all objects are just included. So the intuition behind the, this is like this, that you have all attributes, and in real world, usually no object has all attributes. It is a kind of bottom concept. And on the top, you have the vice versa situation where you have all objects, and usually they do not have any common attributes. And then we can proceed to such a concept as an implication. Implication is just designed to show the dependencies between sets of attributes. So there is a mathematical concept how to show the implication, but in natural world, it's can be described in the following way. If you have an implication from A to B, it means that all objects that have A, they also have B. There is some system that could make more implications from the basic theories. So they are called Armstrong rules. For example, you can have always written the rule, if you have A, then you have A, and some more interesting things, like you can add attributes to the left-hand side, which is called promise, and it is a restriction on the set of objects that you are just interested in. And so how can we use this? To get from the formal context a set of implications, there is a procedure called an attribute exploration. The main advantage of this procedure is that it is interactive, and it cooperates with two types of data. On one hand, it is a set of implications, so you have the dependencies that are expressed in the form if A, then B. And on the other hand, you have a set of counterexamples, and they are just your formal context. So I have a demo available on GitHub. You can just proceed with the following example with me. To make things easier and more intuitive, let us consider an example. Let us have a simple program, and input is just one number, and the output is a set of features of a given number. I take into consideration just five of them, like even, odd, prime, factorial, and if the number is divided by three. So this attribute exploration procedure starts with the following. It just asks you whether some implications are true or false. For example, it starts with like following. Is it true that all numbers share all the features from the given set? And we have to provide a counterexample for the system to make it understand that the world is built in some other way. For example, I took the number 2 and have to describe it in terms of features that it is even, factorial, and prime. And then the system thinks that all the numbers are just like the 2 and say that every number is even, factorial, and prime. And so on and so forth. I could provide counterexamples, fill in my table, which is just the representation of binary relation, or formal context, it's just the same things. And when I proceed with answering the questions, at some moment, I give the implication that really should stay true. For example, yep, if you have factorial divided by 3, then it is even. Yep, we can think of theory of numbers, and if we consider a factorial number which is divided by 3, it already has a 3 in its divisors, and so it has 2 just by the definition of factorial. So yes, it should be even. And then, after the procedure just takes you the whole way from all the implications, you get two types of knowledge, actually. On the one hand, you get this set of counterexamples, which say that there are typical numbers that you should check. And for this procedure to work, you need a domain expert that should precisely know how the domain is just organized. So it would be difficult for an arbitrary person to fill the features if he's not acquainted with the domain specific features. So in the end, there are two types. On the left-hand side, we can see all the implications that hold for our small world of numbers described in terms of 5 attributes. That, for example, if the number is prime and divided by 3, then it is odd, and so on. And in some sense, it is very likely to look like a model-based, because you have a set of dependencies, and somehow you could generate the things on the right-hand side. But to make the difference more clear, we could try to rewrite this example in terms of model-based. So we have a set of outputs, and there are just two values for them, the true or false. So the first thing is quite easy, and for example, using pairwise, we get the set of outputs that could be in no way described in real world. Then we have to think of conditions and check that not all of these numbers are just in the set of n, and then we have to consider that if we would like to have just the same numbers, we could add them as a result. And moreover, we have to consider the implications. For the model base, they're just written as in the previous thing. If you have something, then you have something. And this implication for the case of model based would be of two types. First of them is just to say, what are the implications that we get through attribute exploration? And on the other hand, so there should be some data driven just to match the result with the output. So in the end, we finally set up with the same representation. So the binary table is just like we get from the formal concept analysis. And so what are the main pros of the approach of using attribute exploration? You have two parts of the result. On one hand, it is test cases just written in the form of objects. And then on the other hand, you have dependencies between attributes. And you do not have to keep track in your head of all the possibilities that are just able to be. So this procedure just stores information. Also, the set of attributes can be extended at any moment, and you can start from any part. You can provide some counterexamples and ask what are implications for these examples, and then to proceed. And if you just decided to extend the set of attributes, what you have to do for the existing objects, you have to mark what objects just really has these attributes. So the other very nice approach how to use the formal concept analysis towards software testing, we can consider the following: obtaining a formal concept just using white box technique. For example, usually the program has a set of ifs, and then it proceeds to their output, to their return statement. And how to get all the cases done? We just can get labels to each switch statement, and then we can see all the our ways from the beginning just till to the end. And in this way, it's still a formal context, so you have a set of objects that correspond to the paths across your program, and on the other hand, you have labels which ifs you have covered. Then you just do this intuitive procedure of covering all the paths in your graph, and you and with such a nice picture that all the tests that you should do is just shown on the right-hand side. One thing that is not very intuitive, that the implications in this form, they are just about the presence of attributes. So on the left-hand side, there is a small formal context. And according to the theory behind it, we have to write that there is a dependency that even you have just one attribute, just one object, and it has just one attribute, B, then you have the implication then from A, B, and C. It is so because there is a nice rule that if you have something wrong on the left-hand side, then any statement would be right, just from the definition of implication. And how to avoid it? You could just consider all attributes as a pair of attributes. It's actually worse in the case with the numbers. When you have even and odd numbers, there is no number that which is simultaneously even and odd. So another quite good thing about formal concept analysis that you can use this natural order on concepts, for example, to get a nice test report. So this partial order by some assumption on extents or intents, so about on the sets of objects, on the sets of attributes, and all these concepts form a lattice. Just to be brief, for example, we have such a kind of test report. So some tests are just failed, and some of them are not. We're interested in the failed part. We start from drawing the whole diagram of the lattice. So they're ordered from the bottom. There is no objects, and on the top there are all tests in some sense. So then we focus on the failed part, and we get that the most common feature that they share is just login feature, and downside you have some more details about why there are several cases that have failed. So this latest usage is just A good thing, because iceberg analysis is equivalent to finding the most common descriptions of failed tests. So this is of extremely use in big systems with tons of tests, and there is a graphical representation how to get ideas of it. On the other hand, in big systems, this technique could be very useful to get a good representation for finding similar functionality that would, be of a special interest if you just do with features that are quite common and you have almost the same tests and how to find this the same tests. So about the future work, this framework is quite useful, but unfortunately there are some borders. For example, we do not use non-binary attributes, but it is doable. It is called pattern structures and is a part of future work. And another thing, we could use machine learning based on this formal concept analysis. We can just find the hypothesis why some tests failed, and this iceberg picture is just a good glitch how to do this. So thank you. I just hope that this talk was a bit inspiring, and you could find me in the break and give the questions or use the online contacts.
All right. Excellent. Thank you. I just have to wonder, is if we use this model, can we use it to actually figure out JavaScript operations? That might be a good...
Actually, yeah, because there are some research that use these techniques to explore the world of algebraic structures, and I believe that JavaScript is more bounded.
Oh, wow. Well, that would be welcome. I kid JavaScript because I care, people. I actually like JavaScript. And we just have one question. Do you have to provide counterexamples manually, or can it be automated?
Counterexamples should be provided manually, but there are some researchers when you have to find out the features of the counterexample, and this part could be automated. So if you could find that here is an object and what attributes are typical for him, this part could be automated. So the procedure overall is semi-automated. You do not have to keep track of all the possibilities because you just answer one question at a time. But this knowledge of domain is really useful here.
Well, excellent. Thank you again.
Thanks.
Another round of applause for Fedor.